Adams State College. Great stories begin here.
Thank you all for coming to the first lecture after spring break. Hope everyone's surviving the wind out there. We do have two more lectures beyond today during the semester. In 2 weeks, Dr. Jessica Hernandez-Guzman, a visiting professor in physics and math, will be giving a presentation on MMR and Alzheimer's disease, I believe. And then we have Dr. Jared Heaton and a couple of students who will be getting a presentation a little later on in April. So I encourage you to watch out for that one. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Weathers, giving a presentation on mathematics and entertainment.
Thank you all for coming. Probably going to need a little less light here. I guess that'll do. I'm going to be showing several video clips here. So, mathematics and entertainment. Several years ago, I went to a conference and there was a talk that I could not attend that was about mathematics in The Simpsons. And I wish I had been able to go to that, but it kind of got me to thinking about mathematics in popular culture. And in recent years, there have been a number of, I think there was a TV show called Numbers that was supposedly based on some actual mathematics. There have been movies like Good Will Hunting and A Beautiful Mind, and I'm not going to talk about those. I'm going to talk about some lesser known examples and perhaps even more entertaining examples of mathematics in entertainment. And I'm going to start with a guy that you've probably never heard of, but many mathematicians have heard of him. And in fact, if you were to poll a group of mathematicians and ask them, who is your favorite mathematician turned entertainer who composes and performs satirical and humorous songs about math and science based on Broadway show tunes, this guy would almost certainly be in the top five. Okay. Tom Lehrer was a student at Harvard in the 40s, I think, finished up with his master's degree, taught various places, but his real love is musical theater. And so he built a career out of essentially silly songs about various things. And I'm going to show you, what I'm going to show you is a fan video, basically. Tom Lehrer's heyday was in the 60s, 70s, and so many of his performances are audio only, okay? And so what's happened here is some fan out there has made this video to go along with the song here. And so let's just see, or hear, or both. Make sure I have the volume where we need it, and
how mean sheep when you're trying to sleep being fair, when there's something to share being neat, when you're folding a sheet, that's mathematics when a ball bounces off of a wall and you cook from a recipe book when you know how much money you owe. That's mathematics. How much gold can you hold in an elephant's ear? When it's noon on the moon, then what time is it here? If you could count for a year, would you get to infinity or somewhere in that vicinity? When you choose how much postage to use, when you know what's the chance it will snow, when you bet and you end up in debt. Oh, try as you may, you just can't get away from mathematics. Andrew Wiles gently smiles, does his thing, and wah, QED, we agree, and we all shout hurrah as he confirms what Fermat jotted down in that margin, which could have used some enlarging. Tap your feet, keeping time to a beat of a song, while you're singing along, harmonize with the rest of the guys. Yes, try as you may, you just can't get away from mathematics.
Okay, so There's Tom Lehrer's take on what is mathematics. A little silly at points, noon on the moon and that sort of thing. But as I mentioned, Tom Lehrer did not just mathematics. He also did songs about a variety of things. Poisoning Pigeons in the Park is one of his more famous ones. And he wrote a song to sing the elements of the periodic table. And I don't know if any of the chemists in here have ever seen this, but again, it's a fan video because he did it audio only, but it's a pretty nice fan video, I think you'll agree. And so in keeping with the whole math and science thing, we'll do some science here. And let's listen to this one. Okay, anytime now. Well, that's interesting. It worked in rehearsal. All right, well, see what we can do is come over here, and if I can find the correct one. Let's see, with periodic table. We'll just watch this separately.
That sounds like ammonium, arsenic, aluminum, selenium, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, uranium, nickel, neodymium, neptunium, germanium, and iron, americium, ruthenium, uranium, europium, zirconium, lutetium, vanadium, and lanthanum, and osmium, and astatine, and radium, and gold, protactinium, and indium, and gallium, and iodine, and thorium, and thulium, and thallium. There's yttrium, ytterbium, actinium, rubidium, and boron, gadolinium, niobium, iridium, aspartium, and silicon, and silver, and samarium, and bismuth, chromium, lithium, beryllium, and barium. There's holmium, and helium, and hafnium, and erbium, and phosphorus, and francium, and fluorine, and terbium, and manganese, and mercury, molybdenum, magnesium, dysprosium, and scandium, and cerium, and cesium, and lead, praseodymium, and platinum, plutonium, palladium, promethium, potassium, polonium, and tantalum, technetium, titanium, tellurium, and cadmium, and calcium, and chromium, and curium. There's sulfur, californium, and fermium, berkelium, and also mendelinium, einsteinium, nobelium, and argon, kryptonium, radon, and rhodium, and chlorine, copper, cobalt, copper, tungsten, tin, and sodium. These are the only ones of which the news has come to Harvard, and there may be many others, but they haven't been discovered.
Okay, so who spotted the misspelled one? No? There'll be a quiz. The remarkable thing about this, to me, is that he played and sang this at the same time. I mean, and that's, I wouldn't even be able to say it all, probably, much less play it. And that's kind of a interesting historical artifact from my past. At one time, I decided as an undergraduate, I wanted to be a troubadour, a minstrel. I was going to sit out on the sidewalk with my case. I was going to sing and play, and people were going to throw money at me. But it just, I guess it wasn't meant to happen. I was not coordinated enough to be able to sing and play at the same time. I tried for months and months, and finally, I got so disgusted, I just gave up saxophone altogether. Now, remember I said this is a fan video. Some fan of chemistry, some chemist maybe somewhere made this. It turns out there are a surprising number of versions of this. There's one version that gives you sort of visuals on what the elements should be. Anybody get it? So what do we have here? Europium, right? Okay, maybe there are some others, but I think this was intended to be europium, which tells you absolutely nothing about what europium is, what it looks like. So a slightly more helpful version actually shows some of the elements, and so there's oxygen somewhere. Not really sure where. That's not exactly helpful. There's even, if you want to learn the words, there's even a sing-along version where they scroll through, and you can follow along like that if you want. But wait, there's more. There's even a nice animated, someone did a pencil-drawn hand animation for this thing, which must have taken quite a long time. And then there is a stop-motion Lego animated version where the little Lego guy is singing. And let's see, is Alan here? Okay, well, there's even a SpongeBob version where someone has gone through and pulled video out of the SpongeBob show and fixed it so that it goes with the music somewhat. I think my favorite, though, is this one, Edgar the Puppet singing. And you see, this is his YouTube debut. Okay. You got to wonder how much time people put in to these projects. I mean, now, if you look at the mathematics ones for Tom Lehrer, you look on YouTube, there's a few, but not nearly as many as there are for these Elements ones. Okay. Now, I don't want to suggest that there's something about chemists and fans of chemists that makes them go off the deep end a little bit sometimes, but, you know, sometimes the evidence speaks for itself. So perhaps it's the chemicals. Of course, there might be a hereditary component to it as well. I don't know if you can see there that's not a dog. It's a girl playing a dog. But anyway, fun stuff. And speaking of this group, let's go to the real group here. This is obviously a clip from The Wizard of Oz, and in this clip, the Scarecrow is about to get his brain. It's a Ph.D., a Doctor of Thinkology, from the Wizard. And of course, immediately upon receiving this, he demonstrates his newfound knowledge. And let's take a look at that. Okay, now let's see. What was that he said when he got his brain? He said this: the sum of the square roots of any two sides of an isosceles triangle is equal to the square root of the remaining side. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Okay. Well, in symbols, this is what he stated here. If you have an isosceles triangle with side lengths A, B, and C, then the sum of the square roots of two sides is the square root of the other. And this is wrong. Yeah. And it's pretty easy to see why it's wrong if you consider these values. If you let A and B equal to 1 and C equal 4, satisfies this equation, but you'd be hard-pressed, I think, to make a triangle that had side lengths 1, 1, and 4. Right? The 4 is simply too big. There is no triangle here. Well, what was it he was trying to say? Everybody knows. He was trying to say the Pythagorean theorem, right? Which, well, for starters, doesn't say about isosceles triangles. It refers to right triangles, okay? And it also doesn't say with the square roots. It says it with the squares, okay? And it's not just any two sides to the third one. It's specifically the two short legs to the hypotenuse, right? In a right triangle. So, well, that's what happens when you get your degree from a non-accredited source, I guess. This also demonstrates to us that the Scarecrow must not have been a fan of Gilbert and Sullivan. Because if he had seen The Pirates of Penzance, which is a Gilbert and Sullivan play, he would probably have known that his statement about the triangle lengths was incorrect. Pirates of Penzance, Broadway play. This is a movie adaptation from 1983, which I'm not that familiar with, but apparently it's Pirates of Penzance and a few assorted bits from other Gilbert and Sullivan productions thrown in. And what we're going to look at, the clip, and I apologize for the poor quality, but it was the best I could get. We're going to look at the clip where this guy comes in, the modern major general, and he has a nice little song about being a modern major general and all of the qualifications and expertise that gives him.
For he is a major general.
It teaches a hilarious thing to be a major general.
I am the very muffle of a modern major general. I'm information vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and I quote the fights historical from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both as simple and quadratical about binomial theorem and I'm dealing with a lot of news. Lot of news. Got it. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
I'm very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and in calculus. In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
In short, in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern major general.
All right. Did you recognize the music? Yeah, that's the music from the Elements song. I told you it's based on Broadway show tunes. By the way, the That's Mathematics is based on That's Entertainment, right, by Judy Garland. I only know that because I looked it up for this talk. I don't listen to Judy Garland. But the great thing about this, I think, is the look on Kevin Kline's face when he says, many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. And Kevin Kline's like, what are you people doing here smoking? So many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse, obviously referring there to the Pythagorean theorem, although I'm not sure that I ever felt particularly cheerful regarding facts about the square of the hypotenuse. And I'm not really sure how many facts there would be about the square of the hypotenuse other than Pythagorean theorem. But there you go. I recommend watching Pirates of Penzance. It's neat. There's Kevin Kline there. Angela Lansbury is a very, very young-looking Angela Lansbury is also in this. So let's go back a little ways and let's talk about Abbott and Costello. Everybody's heard of Abbott and Costello. And you've probably heard of the Who's on First routine. I think everybody has heard of that. And so here, if you're not familiar with him, Bud Abbott, he's the tall, skinny guy. He plays the straight man to the lovable goofball of Costello here. And we're going to look at a clip from this movie, Little Giant. And in the clip that we're going to see, Costello is applying for a job as a vacuum cleaner salesman. And Bud Abbott is the owner of the thing. And they're discussing how many salesmen it's going to take to reach the sales goals per week that he has for the vacuum cleaner company. And so here we go.
Mr. Chairman, 28 vacuums a week, that's a lot of vacuums to sell. And you only have 7 salesmen?
Certainly.
That means they got to sell 13 vacuums apiece.
You're right, Keaton. 13 vacuum cleaners apiece?
Yes, sir.
What are you talking about? 7 times 13 is not 28.
Yes, it is.
7 times 4 is 28.
Mr. Chairman, 7 times 13 is 28.
7 times 4 is 28. Do you want to go to school, stupid?
Yes, sir. And I come out the same way.
You claim the 7 goes into 28, 13 times?
That's right.
Go ahead, prove it, prove it, prove it. Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. Come on. Go ahead, go ahead. ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to prove it.
Go ahead.
Now, you've got seven salesmen.
That's right.
Okay. There's a seven.
Where is it?
Right there.
All right.
Now, you've got 28 packages a week you got to sell.
That's right.
I'm going to divide. There's your 28 packages.
Now, wait, do you claim the seven goes in the 28, 13 diet?
That's right.
Show me.
Seven at the two. Seven more at the two.
Certainly not.
So I got to take the two from there and put it down here.
Put it down there?
Yeah, I'm going to use that at one. That's a cute little two.
Yeah.
Now, seven to eight.
Once.
Once. I'm going to carry seven from here and put it under the eight. Seven from eight.
What?
One. A minute ago, I didn't use that little two.
What are you going to do?
I got to use that two now. I'm going to take it from there, and I'm going to put it right there. Now, seven to 21.
Pretty bad.
That's correct. 7 to 28, 13.
Oh, no. What kind of figures are these?
Just a minute. That's about right.
We'll multiply this. Go ahead.
Multiply?
Put down 13.
Okay, 13.
That's right. That's seven salesmen. Put that down.
Seven salesmen.
You claim that 7 times 13 amounts to what?
28.
Prove that.
7 times 3?
21.
7 times 1?
7.
7 and 1?
8.
And 2.
29. No. No, you can't.
That's right.
No, nothing of the kind. We'll add this up.
And?
Put down 13 7 times.
Okay.
1.
2.
2
3.
3.
4.
5.
Six, seven.
Now, wait a minute. You claim that all that added up amounts to what?
28.
If it does, you've got a job.
Thank you. 3.
Oh, no, wait a minute. 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21.
22, 23, 24, 25, 26,
27. Okay, well, clearly that's wrong, but what's wrong about it? Can anybody in four words or less say what was wrong here? What did he do wrong?
Place value.
Yeah, he didn't respect the place value of the one. Right? He treated the one as a one, not as a 10. And well, if the one is a one, then the one in the three is a four, and 7 times 4 is 28. Okay. They use this gag in several of their movies with various setups. It occurs in several installments of the Ma and Pa Kettle series of movies from the 50s, and probably some other places as well. But it's always fun to see Costello get the best of Abbott. Well, so we've looked at some movies and some songs. You had to know that eventually we were going to get to some science fiction. Okay, and of course, you think about math nerds and science fiction television shows, you must be talking about Red Dwarf. Now, Red Dwarf was a series that ran starting in 1992, I believe, on the BBC, and it's a science fiction comedy kind of thing. It's quite a good show. I recommend it heartily. And it concerns the adventures of these guys. Okay, so here's the cast. And let me give you a little heads up. Okay, so this is Dave Lister, and at one time he was the lowest ranking member on the mining ship Red Dwarf, and was put into stasis for a violation of the rules. He brought on a pregnant cat onto the ship, and so was put into stasis for the rest of the journey, deprived of all pay and benefits. And while he was in there, his bunkmate, who is the second lowest ranking guy on the ship, performed a faulty repair that led to a radiation leak that killed everybody. And the computer kept him in stasis until it was safe to come out. So he was in stasis for 3 million years. So he's quite possibly the last human being alive. This is a hologrammatic projection of his ex-bunkmate. This is a creature that evolved from the cat. Okay, so there's the pregnant cat in the cargo hold, safely, not affected by the radiation. I'm not sure why there aren't thousands or millions of them running around on the ship, but hey, it's science fiction. This is Crichton, and he is a mechanoid. They take care not to use any of the words the other shows use. So he's not an android, he's a mechanoid. Basically a manservant, particularly good at cleaning lavatories. And we're going to watch a clip from an episode called Quarantine. And in this clip, they have just got back from scavenging a remote outpost, an abandoned remote outpost, and they've brought back some some vials. And what they've just figured out, or what Crichton has just figured out, is that these vials contain beneficial viruses. Okay, so things like charisma, sex appeal, happiness, okay, these are all generated by benevolent viruses. And, well, I'll let him take it from there.
This one is the most intriguing of all. According to my notes, this is the viral strain Felicitas populi, commonly known as Luck. Luck is a virus, a positive virus which most humans contract at some point in their lives for very short periods. And here it is, Lady Luck in liquid form. Want to try some? Is it safe? Absolutely harmless. Even so, this is a minute dose and will only last for about 3 minutes. Now, I want you to pick out all the aces from this pack of cards. Shuffle them. Mm-hmm. 13 to 1. 221 to 1. 5,525 to 1. 270,725 to 1. Sir, I want you to throw this dart over here into that bullseye behind you using your left hand without looking.
Left hand.
He's
a bullseye.
Mm-hmm.
Without looking.
No chance.
Trust me, sir.
I think that indicates the luck virus.
Okay. So Lister pulls out all the aces, and you saw that as he was pulling them out, Crichton was giving the odds against pulling the aces out to emphasize how good the luck virus was. And so let's see if that's correct. And we need a little bit of basic probability here. And there's some technical details, but basically if you have all outcomes of an experiment equally likely, like for instance rolling a six-sided die, then the probability of any outcome E is simply this, the number of ways that you can get E divided by the total number of possible outcomes. So for instance, if you're rolling the six-sided die, what's the probability you get a 4? Well, there's only one way you can get a 4, right? And there are 6 possible outcomes. So the probability of rolling a 4 would be 1/6, okay? So let's look at the cards now. All right, on his first draw, when he first picked up the deck, there were 4 aces in the deck. Okay, and there were 52 cards. So his probability of drawing an ace on any given draw is simply 1/13. Okay, does that make sense? Now, what about the second draw? Well, on the second draw, he's removed one of the aces. So now there are only 3 aces remaining out of a total of 51 cards. Okay, what this gives, though, is the probability that the second card he draws is an ace. And he's drawing all 4 of them out, so we have to take into account that he already drew one ace. He's going to draw another, and the way we handle that is we multiply them. So the probability that he gets 2 aces, well, there was the probability of getting the first one, and there's the probability of getting the second one. The probability is 1 out of 221. Seems fairly unlikely. Okay, what about the third draw? Well, now he's down to 50 cards in the deck, 2 of which are aces. So 1/25, this represents the probability that the third card is an ace, but again, he's gotten 2 aces already, so the overall probability of getting the 3 aces, we take the previous one, which was, right, this was the probability of 2, multiply it by the third, 1/5,525, okay? What about the fourth draw? Well, by the time he gets to the fourth draw, there's only 1 ace remaining out of 49 cards, so we take the previous number, multiply by 1/49. And there is the probability of pulling out 4 aces from the deck. So, seems okay, doesn't it? The only problem is it isn't, okay? The reason it isn't is that there's a difference between probability and odds, okay? The probability, well, let's see, so probability, we define that. What about odds? Let's talk about odds for a moment. What's the difference? Well, the odds against an event occurring, okay? So you, when you talk about odds, you can talk about it two ways. You can do odds in favor or odds against. But typically when you see odds like in the paper for sports events or something, it's usually odds against an event. And so the odds against an event occurring defined like this, the probability of not E, in other words, the probability that E does not occur divided by the probability that E does occur. And if we look at this in the context of the first draw, then the odds against, well, if the probability of getting an ace on that first draw was 1/13, then the probability of not getting an ace must be 12/13, right? Because you got to get something. And so we see that the odds against drawing 12-1, not 13-1, but 12-1. This is a very common mistake. In fact, if you go to the Colorado Lottery page and look up the information about the Colorado Lottery, they give you probabilities and odds of winning. They make this exact same mistake. They don't subtract the one from here. And so, if we look at it like this, you can see that, I mean, it's just off by one, so the difference between 221-1 and 220-1 is probably slim, but to be precise, okay, we have to subtract that one from here. And so Crichton, unfortunately, is not quite correct, but, I mean, he cleans toilets. So, now you'll notice, by the way, that when I introduce the definition of odds against, it's written as a fraction, but you normally see them written this way. Okay, and you would read this 5,524-1. And the fact that the first number is bigger means that it's extremely unlikely that this will happen. I guess it's easier to distinguish between probability and odds if you always write your odds this way. But of course, the other thing is nobody likes fractions. Ooh, you don't want to write 12 over 1 as odds against. It's a fraction. We don't like fractions. We'll write it as 12-1. Well, it turns out that the dislike of fractions is almost universal. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at a clip from the movie Apocalypse Now. And in this scene, well, in this movie, if you haven't seen it, Marlon Brando plays a rogue army commander in Vietnam. Martin Sheen's character has been sent to rein in the Marlon Brando's character at all costs, which could have been good practice for reining in his kids. But at any rate, so there we go. Marlon Brando's character and Martin Sheen. And Dennis Hopper is, well, he's pretty much Dennis Hopper in this. And so let's see. By the way, R-rated language warning here.
Nine, no maybes, no supposes, no fractions. You can't travel in space. You can't go out into space, you know, without, like, you know, with fractions. What are you going to land on? 1/4, 3/8? What are you going to do when you go from here to Venus or something? That's dialectic physics, okay? Dialectic logic is there's only love and hate. You either love somebody or you hate them.
So that Brando's reaction there, I often get that in my classes when I start talking about fractions. So I wonder if Hopper here teamed up with some chemists prior to the shooting of this. But anyway, it's a good movie, Apocalypse Now. If you haven't seen it, you should see it. I won't ruin it for you by telling you that he kills Brando's character at the end. Now, what says America more than the Andy Griffith Show? By the way, if you're student age or lower, there's nothing wrong with the color on this. Okay? It used to be that the world was in black and white up until sometime in the 60s. So the Andy Griffith Show, one of the all-time greats. TV Guide magazine actually rated this the 9th best TV show of all time, and one of my personal favorites. And we're going to take a look at a clip from an episode called Mayberry Goes Bankrupt. And in this clip, there's an old guy who had a beat down house on the edge of town, and they finally got tired of the eyesore, so they decided to condemn his house and evict him. And in the process of Sheriff Taylor evicting him, they came across some of his possessions. And well, hey, one of his possessions happened to be a bond issued by the city of Mayberry some time before. And well, I'll let the clip tell the rest. All right, well, let's check and see how good those machines at the bank are. So let's talk about compound interest a little bit. Okay. So compound interest differs from simple interest in that you earn interest on the interest you already earned. That's what makes it compound. So let's imagine that he bought the bond for $100 and it pays 8.5% annually. So at the end of the first year, it would get compounded. So there's the amount that he started with, and then it earns 8.5%. So at the end of 1 year, it would be worth $108.50. Okay, that makes sense, doesn't it? Now, what about the second year? Well, at the second year when it compounds, you're now compounding based on the $108.50 from the year before. So there's the $108.50 that you had from the year before, and now here is the interest that that amount will earn. And you can do the calculations, turns out $117.72. And at the end of the third year, it happens again. Right? You take the amount from the previous year, and of course that's still there. Think of this as an account or something. It's still there. And then here's the interest that it earns, and you can go through the calculations and figure that at the end of the third year, it would be worth $127.73. Okay? There's got to be a pattern here. Wouldn't be math if there wasn't a pattern. Let's go back to this one. The first year, when they compound the interest, notice that we could factor the 100 out of both of these terms, and we would come up with an expression that looks like this, which does multiply out to be $108.50. Okay? Now, at the end of the next year, what we can do, this is the way we had it written before, right? But if we split things up, well, 108.50, that's this guy, 108.50, we put that here. Well, look, we can factor this term, 100 times 1.085, 100 times 1.085. We can factor that out of both terms. Now, when I factor it out of here, what's left is a 1. When I factor it out of here, what's left is the 0.085. And, well, hey, look, 1 plus, that's 1.085 again. 1.085 squared. Starting to see a pattern. What happens at the end of the next year? Well, I've kind of cut some of the middleman stuff out, but what you can see is that you pick up yet another factor of the 1.085. And every time this is compounded, what's really happening is it's getting multiplied by 1.085. Right? The 1 corresponds to the fact that the money you had before, you still have, and then the 0.085 is the interest that that earns. So every compounding is equivalent to just multiplying by another factor of 1.085. So after n compounding periods, this should be the value of the bond. And so what do we say? Drum roll, please. If we do this to the 100th power, sure enough, $349,119.27. So they must be good machines. Okay. He never gets his money, by the way. It's kind of sad, but he does get his house fixed up. Okay. You knew we had to get to Star Trek eventually. And this is probably the most famous episode of Star Trek ever. The clip we're going to look at is what happens right after they discover that the Tribbles have essentially taken over all the storage compartments and eaten all the grain that they were taking to this place. And let's see the clip. Okay, I'm not sure what the volume of the storage compartment and all that had to do with it. It seems a pretty straightforward calculation, so let's check it. Let's see if Spock was correct in the number of tribbles. Okay, so remember the assumptions was that they started with one tribble, and every 12 hours, each tribble has a litter of 10 little tribbles. So what we'll do, let's imagine that we're going to measure time in increments of 12 hours, okay? So when it started, the very beginning, there was one tribble, all right? Now, at t equals 1, remember 1 would mean one 12-hour period later, how many would we have? Well, there would be the tribble that was there to start with, right, plus its 10 offspring, okay? So after 12 hours, there would be 11 tribbles. At the end of the next 12-hour period, whoops, other way, there would be the 11 tribbles that were there before, plus 10 offspring per tribble, so 110 offspring. So now you're up to 121, okay? At 3, well, we've got the 121 tribbles who were there 12 hours ago, plus 10 offspring per tribble, 1,331 tribbles. Now, I hear some grumbling out there. I think maybe some folks have seen the pattern here, but does anybody see what's going on with these numbers here? Any non-mathematicians see what's going on with these numbers here? Yes? So what is the pattern in these numbers here?
It's going up by one and then adding itself in the middle. So the next one would be 1, 4, 4, 4, 1.
Maybe. I think you're on to it there. The idea is that at each step you have the number of tribbles in the previous step plus 10 times the number of tribbles. So 10 and then the 1. It's a factor of 11, right? And so at each time there's another generation of tribbles, the tribble population increases by a factor of 11. And sure enough, if you look at that, 11 121, 13, 31. So at the end of the fourth time period, there should be 11 to the fourth, 11 to the fifth, etc. In general, after n time periods, there would be 11 to the n triples. And who remembers the number that Spock said? No, no, no. For the total number of tribbles. Nobody remembered that. 1,771,561. And so, hey, Spock was right about that. Alrighty. Now, I have another clip that I will... I think we have enough time for this. You may remember in the song there, the That's Mathematics song, he made some remark about... verified what Fermat wrote down in the margin, which could have used some enlarging. He's referring to Fermat's last theorem, of course. And I have another Star Trek clip that refers to Fermat's last theorem. So let's take a look at that. And this is the Next Generation, the captain who can act, or not overact, at least.
Fermat's last theorem. You're familiar with it?
Vaguely. Spent too many math classes daydreaming about being on a starship.
When Pierre de Fermat died, they found this equation scrawled in the margin of his notes. X to the n plus y to the n equals z to the n, where n is greater than 2, which he said had no solution in whole numbers. But he also added this phrase, remarkable proof.
Yeah, that started to come back to me. There was no proof included.
Mm-hmm. For 800 years, people have been trying to solve it.
Including you.
I find it stimulating. Also, it puts things in perspective. In our arrogance, we feel we are so advanced. And yet, we cannot unravel a simple knot tied by a part-time French mathematician working alone without a computer.
Yeah, I think we detected some sort of debris in the blue floor.
Anyway, that's fine.
I suggest we name the section aboard for now.
Make it so, number one.
So Riker definitely changes the subject there, which I get that a lot when I start talking about math, too. The interesting thing, you see that the date on this was 1989, but Fermat's last theorem was actually proven about 10 years after this by Andrew Wiles. That was the other reference in the song. And so it's kind of a interesting conundrum when you do TV shows like this. And if you've ever seen any of the old TV shows that talk about 50 years from now, the Russians will be in charge, and well, the Soviets, and there aren't any Soviets anymore. So predicting the future is a dicey thing. Interestingly enough, in the Star Trek Deep Space Nine series, they make up for this because at one point they refer to the proof of Fermat's last theorem. So I guess they figured they had to go back and tie that up. But anyway, so there's some fun examples, I hope, of math and entertainment. And I'll take questions now. No?
Adams State College. Great stories begin here.